Wherever society draws the line, it's difficult.
James Ferman was one of the most powerful film censors in the history of the British Board of Film Classification. For over 25 years, from 1975 until 1999, he led the BBFC through rapidly changing times in Britain, from the grim 1970s to the prosperous 1980s, right up until the end of the Cool Britannia period of the 1990s. He was in the job so long that, as film producer Stephen Willey has rightly pointed out, James Ferman and the BBFC were thought of as one and the same. He will surely go down in British film history as the longest running film censor the BBFC have ever had or ever likely to have again. James Ferman became head censor, which is a role then known as the secretary, in June 1975. He had taken over the role from previous head censor Stephen Murphy, whom, after only 4 years in the role, retired due to the pressures put upon him by forces outside of his control. The mounting backlash against the free-love 1960s had given way to the angry and disillusioned 1970s, and Murphy found it hard to keep the board out of controversy. The main function of the BBFC is to keep both the film industry and public happy with its work at the same time. Murphy found this hard because films with an increasing amount of sex and violence were being made, at a time when traditional social groups in England were trying to return England to a time of social conservatism. That is to say, they wanted both film and TV to cater for the family audience and the family audience alone. This meant that any film which entered the X category, what we now know as the 18 certificate today, was liable to be seized upon by protest groups such as the National Viewers and Listeners Association, the NVLA, led by the formidable Mary Whitehouse, as decaying the moral fabric of the British way of life. Stephen Murphy resigned in 1975, and in June of that year, the then BBFC president, Lord Harlech, appointed James Ferman as the new head censor. Lord Harlech took the young former TV director under his wing and began to coach Ferman in the art of public relations. We're not to say too little, and we're not to say too much. From this moment on, James Ferman was on the ascent. Ferman made his mark right from the offset. He recalled movies passed by his predecessor Stephen Murphy and made cuts. In doing so, one could argue that this was a backhanded criticism of Murphy and its loose policy in terms of representations of rape in particular. One of the most famous examples of this decision was the recall Emmanuel for further cuts in 1978, which was still playing in many cinemas at the time. He even recalled Enter the Dragon to remove all visuals of the infamous nunchucks. This anti-nunchucks policy would reach epic proportions as the BBFC entered into the 1980s, but it would be unfair to criticise Ferman for this policy at this stage. This is because England in the 1970s went through a sort of kung fu craze, and people who saw films involving nunchucks were reported to be making them themselves in woodshop in schools and brandishing them in public. As silly as this all sounds now, this was a real concern for Ferman, who felt that he could never allow himself to be responsible, even partially, for anyone behaving violently as a result of films he himself had passed. Whilst he did not necessarily agree with the cause and effect argument regarding cinematic violence, he did feel that watching violence over a period of time caused gradual erosion of people's sensibilities and their ability to be shocked. This he called the drip-drip effect, and it is an argument he would repeat throughout his career.
I don't think one rape scene in any film has ever made anybody go out and commit a rape, but I think the drip-drip-drip effect of seeing one rape scene after another, week after week, by people who seek out entertainment of that kind, and see rape films which appear to have no consequences at all, or indeed rape scenes in which the woman, halfway through the rape, responds to the experience, flings her arms around the rapist's shoulders, and has a glorious orgasm, and then thanks him for this liberating experience.
I totally reject the cause and effect argument. I don't think any film that I can remember has had a direct effect and caused a crime, except possibly, and it's 20 years since I saw it, 25 years since I saw it, Clockwork Orange, where there were attacks on tramps afterwards, and there were some rapes. that appeared to be inspired by that film. I think that's why Kubrick withdrew it, because it was very embarrassing having all these stories in the press. Now, I've never checked up on those stories, and they may not be true at all, but I think it's much more the drip-drip effect.
Ferman recalled and cut films like Emmanuel at a time where he succeeded to bring film under the Obscene Publication Act. This was Ferman's first masterstroke, and a key example why it would be unfair to criticise Ferman simply as a scissor-happy censor. Ferman loved film, and was not against the representation of sex and violence if there was a morally plausible reason for a filmmaker to do so. By bringing film under the OPA, a film could only be considered obscene in a court if the film taken as a whole could be seen as potentially depraving and corrupting. At around the same time, Ferman viewed the infamous Salo, 120 Days of Sodom, by renowned filmmaker Pier Paolo Pasolini. He admired the film greatly and wanted it to be seen uncut. However, he knew that public perception of a film that features sex, violence and rape on such a large scale would cause significant problems. So to that end, he followed the time-honored tradition of allowing private members-only cinema clubs in London to screen it in order to gauge public response. This was done successfully by former head censor John Trevelyan, and it's one that Ferman had hoped would work for him. Unfortunately, events didn't turn out that way. The private cinema showing the film was raided by the police and the film confiscated. Unlike Trevelyan, however, Ferman didn't challenge the police, but instead wrote a letter to the Director of Public Prosecutions outlining his reasons for why he felt that the definition of obscenity as far as the law was concerned did not apply to Salo. This didn't change the DPP's mind, however, so Ferman tried a different tact. He took the film into the editing room and made cuts. Not only that, he added a written prologue at the beginning of the film to try and add some context to the mayhem. Film historians always cite Ferman's re-editing of Henry's Portrait of a Serial Killer in 1990 as an example of how this frustrated former TV director went beyond his job description and changed the representations in a film, but it was actually here in 1978 that he first performed this controversial move. Ferman also had the problem with the local authorities to deal with, a problem that plagued his predecessor. It is worth noting, in the interest of context, that the BBFC are only an advisory body when it comes to film in the cinema. The actual power lies with each local authority in the UK. For instance, in Kent there are very different local authorities for each district. Each of those local authorities can decide on what films can and can't be shown in their areas, even if that film had a BBFC certificate. Ferman was wary of the wildly disorganised way in which BBFC decisions were taken by each of the many local authorities in the UK. To this end, Ferman took a gamble which effectively consolidated the power of the BBFC, whilst making local authorities not so keen to exercise their powers in the future. Ferman produced a monthly newsletter detailing all the BBFC's decisions for that month, and made the newsletter available to any interested local authority for an annual fee. At first the interest was high, which made the film industry very, very nervous. When this fear was relayed back to Ferman, he calmly insisted to the industry to trust him. He knew what he was doing. Sure enough, when the local authorities realised just how dull the BBFC's bread and butter day-to-day work was, interest in their work fell, and Ferman was able to finally draw a line under local authority intrusion and close the doors on the workings of the BBFC to the outside world. This would eventually be his undoing, but for now it suited Britain at a time when it needed some calm after the stormy tenure of Stephen Murphy. The industry left the BBFC alone for now, but this wasn't the end of matters as far as the contrary attitude of the BBFC to local government authorities were concerned. In 1979, there were local authorities who banned Monty Python's comedy satire, The Life of Brian. But this was a far cry from the constant second-guessing that Murphy had to put up with during his time at the BBFC. Curiously enough, the local authorities were not to contradict the BBFC again until 1993, when many local authorities reversed the BBFC decision to give family comedy Mrs. Doubtfire a 12 certificate, and instead gave it a PG. The BBFC responded to this by recalling the film and making cuts to dialogue involving sexual innuendo, in order to keep the film in tune with the views of the local authorities in regards to this film. It was then passed PG again for its video release. One could argue that at this stage, James Ferman making the cuts for the 12 could have been a sop to the local authorities, but on the other hand, in order for it to be a PG, James Ferman insisted that the sexual innuendo had to be cut out, because he felt that that particular dialogue was just not suitable for children to hear. So in this regard, even if James Ferman could be seen as doing a little bit of a U-turn, he still dug his heels in when it came to the representations of something that he felt children should simply not see under any circumstance, which is fair enough. Another key milestone during Ferman's early years was the passing of the Protection of Children's Act of 1978. This was the first law to explicitly make and or exhibit indecent images of children illegal. Whilst Ferman wholeheartedly supported the law, there are two films of quality which technically broke this law. These films were Ano Corrida in the Realm of the Senses in 1976 and Louis Malle's Pretty Baby in 1978. Both films featured child nudity in a sexualized context, which undoubtedly contravened the new law. Ferman's approach was interesting. He sent Ano Corrida to a top film production company and asked them to reframe the offending images so you don't actually see the offense take place. He kept it in the film because it was key to the film's dramatic structure and made it clear to the audience that the woman who commits the act is unstable. We as the audience draw back from her as a response to this act. To take away that act from the film would be to ruin the actual flow of the film. In the case of Pretty Baby, it was not as simple as that. The film was seen by a wide array of BBFC hierarchy and even Home Office representatives. Everyone present understood and appreciated the merits of the film. They knew this was a film of quality. This was not just some exploitation piece. But they were unsure of how it would be seen in the public after the passing of the PCA due that summer of that year. Following the passing of the Protection of Children's Act into law in July 1978, and taking into account the views of the various people who had seen and considered the film, the board concluded that two minor cuts would be required before the film could be granted an X certificate. Accordingly, a cuts list was sent to the film's distributor on 16th of August 1978. The cuts were as follows. 1. Reel 4. In the scene in the bathroom, delete moment where Madame pulls away the towel which Violet is holding in front for her modesty, and cut straight to the close-ups of Violet and Man looking at each other. 2. Reel 5. Delete full-length nude shot of Violet posing for Bullock on the sofa. These proposed cuts were put to the film's director, Louis Malle, who was very reluctant to make any changes to his film. Although he agreed to make the first cut, in the bathroom scene in Reel 4, he's particularly reluctant to delete the shot where showing Violet lying on the sofa. For him, this was one of the key shots of the film, and a direct reference to the publication Storyville Portraits, whose cover image had inspired the whole project. Accordingly, in October 1978, he met with James Ferman in person to discuss the matter. Following on from that meeting, James Ferman sent a letter to Louis Malle on the 10th of November 1978. He stated, "Since our meeting, I have had a chance to discuss the position further with my colleagues, and I put to them your very strong feelings about the scene in which Violet is posing nude on the sofa. We all appreciate the visual beauty of the shot and the significance it has for you in its evocation of Bullock's photographic style. Yet we cannot see a way round the objection that the model in this case is only 12 years old, and that she has been posed in a manner which many adults would feel be indecent for a child of that age. I mentioned the very important point that you wish to demonstrate the degree to which an obsessive artist like Bullock could inadvertently exploit a child like Violet purely for the sake of his artwork. But I was reminded by my colleagues that, ironically, this charge of an inadvertent exploitation could also be levied at a director making a film on the subject with a child actress." So given Ferman's clear position that the BBFC could not accept this shot as filmed, Louis Malle initially suggested that it might be possible to find an alternative shot in which less detail was visible. However, when his search for alternative takes proved fruitless, he agreed to darken the existing shots so that no detail in the lower half of the girl's body could be clearly visible, most specifically any genital detail. Ultimately, this solution proved acceptable to the board, and the film was finally classified X on the 27th of July 1979. In total, 6 seconds had to be cut from the bathroom scene, in which Violet is displayed naked to a client, and the scene in which Violet lies naked on the sofa had to be optically darkened. Following on from this, in November 1979, James Ferman was able to report to the film's distributor that "You will be relieved to hear the Attorney General was able to announce in the House of Commons last week that the Director of Public Prosecutions is not to take any action against your film, Pretty Baby." Ferman commented about the film in one of the last bulletins to local authorities. "Such a compromise," he said, "has seemed absurd to some commentators, and it may well be that a British jury would have supported them in failing to find the original pose indecent in British law." The final significant event of the decade during Ferman's formative years at the board was the consequence of the Williams Report in 1979. In the report, Williams argued that straightforward pornography was not harmful, could be seen as offensive to some. Therefore, so long as the material itself was not visible to the public, and that anyone whom might take offence to such material could avoid it, the Williams Report saw no harm in non-violent consensual pornography. This would pave the way for the R18 certificate in 1982, a certificate given to pornography intended for sale only in licensed sex shops. The whole issue of pornography is one that would come back to undermine Ferman towards the end of his career. However, in 1979, Ferman could do no wrong. He was on the rise. In the next episode, we look at Ferman's continued rise of power in the 1980s and look how film censorship was undermined by videotape. How the public enjoying a brief freedom of uncensored films and video caused moral panic and hysteria before the British government turned to Ferman and the BBC to once again bring calm to the film industry.